Hello, YouTube. I've been making lots of videos about science and particular creationism because there are just so many people out there who don't even understand the basics. Well, it's become painfully obvious that not a lot of people, even intelligent skeptics, even understand the basics of economics. So, based on a lot of the comments I've had in the last few videos that I've done on economic issues, I was going to sit down and make a video explaining all this stuff. There's just so much, so it's become a series. Right now, I have five different parts planned. This first one is just going to be an economics primer. I'm just going to go very, very basic. Talk about what economics is, what it covers, what it's all about, what a transaction is, and what supply and demand is. So we're going very, very basic here. The second one is going to be lesson one. And you'll say, well, haven't you given us a lesson here? Well, yeah, but this is lesson one, as in the big one, the number one lesson, the thing that you really, really need to understand economics. And I have seen this violated so much in the comments, and I still see it violated so much on TV and the news by the presidential candidates and so forth. So part two is going to be lesson one. Part three is going to be on the wisdom of crowds, and this is in response mainly to those of you who are saying, well, everyone out there is so stupid, I don't trust them to make decisions. And the idea is that if we can just get someone in government who's smart enough or has this special knowledge, that all of a sudden they'll be able to make things better. So part three will completely rebut that. We'll start off, it's actually going to be a response to one of the Penn Says videos, Penn Jillette's videos, about the pumpkin contest, which may have actually been a scientific experiment. And we'll talk about why. We'll talk about Galton's ox, and we'll talk about the jelly bean experiment. So if you want to look ahead for those, you can. Part four is going to be on price controls. And we're going to talk about concepts such as price gouging. We'll talk about what happens to prices in disasters and shortages. We'll talk about some big issues that we've had in the comments, like minimum wage and interest rates, and talk about how the government tries to manipulate them and what happens. And the fifth one is going to be on unemployment. We'll cover voluntary employment, which is the only kind of employment you can have in a free market, and what causes that and what it's all about. And we'll talk about involuntary employment, which is basically employment either directly or indirectly caused by government policies. And it's in two types. There's perpetual unemployment, which is just unemployment that's the same year by year, or maybe it grows steadily or whatever. Then there's cyclical unemployment that goes up and goes down and goes up and goes down. So we'll talk about all of that in all five parts. So this is part one, your basic economics primer. So let's start off with a couple of very basic principles of economics. And these are things that you really have to understand to get this. The first thing you need to understand is that resources are finite. There's only so much stuff in the world. There's only so many things we can do with that stuff. And there's only so much time we have to do it with. But desires are infinite. That's the second one. We always want more. We want more stuff. We want a better life. We want a better life for our kids. And this is true of everybody. I once heard one guy say to me, he said, well, I'm not like that. I've got everything I want. I don't want for anything more. I've got my wife. I've got my family. I've got enough to be comfortable. I don't want any more. And so this second principle of yours doesn't apply to me. And I said to him, are you telling me that if your wife got cancer, you would not want a cure? We always want more, no matter what it is. It's not, this isn't about greed necessarily. I mean, it could be, but it could just be about wanting to cure cancer, wanting to feed the poor, wanting to go out into space and colonize other planets, whatever. However lofty your desire is, it's still a desire and it's still unlimited. So from these two, we can come to a third one. Since resources are finite and since desires are infinite, people are always going to try to do more to fill those desires. And this means a couple of things. The first thing it means is that the free market always tends towards full employment, because we've got all this people, and it takes people to take the resources and turn them into stuff we need, and it wants to maximize that. There are actually three different things that go into this. There's resources, which I mentioned, and labor, which is what you use the people for, that's employment, and there's capital. Now, capital is what brings us to the fourth one, and that is, at what price? What's it worth to you to have this extra thing that you want? This is how the finite resources are managed in the economy, because if there's only so much, then you got to manage it somehow. The price is how you do it. Now, of course, normally we think of the price as being the dollar amount that you charge for it, but there are other things that are involved in a price, such as the time outlay. The price of having the job is his time. He's giving up his time. The price to the employer is the wages, and he gives those to the employee, and that's his price of making the job. So both sides pay a price, which brings us to the fundamental action in economics. Everything in economics is based on a transaction. A transaction is a voluntary agreement between two people to give each other something. They both give something and they both get something. Just to keep it basic, let's say you go to a convenience store, you're thirsty, and so you buy a Coke. Now this Coke costs $1. So you take, you know, the Coke up to the counter, and the, let's say it's the shop owner, he rings it up. And so he says, that'll be $1. You give him the dollar, he gives you the Coke. Now, why did that happen? Well, it happened because you valued the Coke more than you valued the dollar. Conversely, the shop owner valued the dollar more than he valued the Coke. If that wasn't the case on both sides, then the transaction would not have taken place. That's what a transaction is. So there are two things about the transaction. One is it's voluntary, and two is it's win-win. Both sides come out ahead. Always in every voluntary transaction, unless there's some kind of force or fraud going on, a transaction is always voluntary and win-win for both sides. Now this is true whether you're buying something or whether it's employment. Because if you think about what I said earlier, both sides are giving up something. The employee is giving up his time. The employer is giving up his money. The employee does it because he values the money more than he values that amount of time. And the employer does it because he values the work he gets from that worker more than the value of the wages that he pays them. It's a voluntary transaction, and it's win-win for both sides. So from this we come to another principle, which is that in a free market, wealth always increases. And a lot of people seem, you talk about wealth, a lot of people seem to think you're talking about dollar amounts. Well, no, wealth is kind of a nebulous thing. It's just what you value. But since desires are infinite, the tendency of the market is to always get greater value and to always increase more wealth. And so what that means is that people, in by whatever criteria they want to estimate themselves by, they always end up better off than they were before. If that's ever not the case, then it's usually because of some government intervention or some kind of natural disaster or something else that happens outside of the market forces to make that happen. So what are these market forces doing? Well, it's all based on supply and demand. Here's the supply and demand graph. You probably remember seeing it in one of my other videos. The supply curve is upward sloping. What that means is that suppliers want to provide more of a particular item at higher prices and less at lower prices. The demand curve is downward sloping, which means that people want to buy more of it if it's at a lower price than they do if it's at a higher price. Now, where these two curves cross, you have two equilibriums. You have an equilibrium price and an equilibrium quantity. We'll talk more about this when we talk about price controls, and we'll talk about what happens when you get away from this, but for the purposes of this video, just know that the economy is always going to be seeking the equilibrium price and quantity so that there are no shortages or surpluses, and that there is no overcharging or undercharging. That's the basics of economics, as much as I can cram into a 10-minute video, so we'll pick this up in part 2 with lesson 1.